Hi, everyone. Welcome back. I would like to introduce the next speaker. But before I do that, I want to remind you all to go take advantage of the conference and go visit all the booths, all the things, all the games, maybe win some swag, and enjoy the conference. Right now, I'm going to introduce Nicolas, who is talk about APIs.
Hi, everybody. Thanks to be here. This is actually a big room. That's my second time at HipCon, and I was there for Vox Days Belgrade. Who was there for the first edition of Vox Days Belgrade? Yeah. Not that many people. Probably less and less every year. I'm Nicolas Frankel. For a long time, I was a developer, a team lead, an architect, a solution architect. And then I became dissatisfied with projects. I became dissatisfied with management. I became dissatisfied with stupid schedules, ever-changing requirements, people who didn't listen to me. So I went to developer advocacy. So now I come, I give my talk. If you don't do what I'm saying, that's fine. I assume you are here because either you created your first HTTP API, or you are intending to do so. And who has already created their first API? Yeah, most of the people. The thing is, you need to think about lots and lots of things. The first one is obviously your entities. How do you model your entities? The relationship between the entities. The boundaries between your entities. Then you've got the rest stuff. The stuff that is very, very important, but that everybody argues about. Like put versus post versus patch, and all the things that cannot be easily modeled in REST. Then you've got the additional problems about, like what I told about, schedule, requirements, whatever. And, well, in that case, when the business comes to do the V2, you are, oh, we didn't think about versioning. Versioning, yeah. So that's probably your reaction. So in this talk, I would like to touch a few points so that if you implement them, and again, it's not mandatory, and I won't know anyway, then you will be much, much better shape. So this is probably your initial situation, right? You have an app, and you've got endpoints. And like clients can't get to your endpoint, right? OK, I'm not in the US, but I will still want a bit more interaction, right? So this is your initial situation, right? OK, you lied. I hope that nobody is in this situation. Probably you have a reverse proxy in front, right? OK, so you all lied the first time. So perhaps, how should I trust you now? Never play the game with a French speaker. Never, never. And my solution is make it an API gateway. It will solve all your problems. Thanks. Do you have questions? So unfortunately, today, I don't have that much time to explain to you the difference between the reverse proxy and the API gateway. In very, very short words, reverse proxy were designed at a time where it was not an issue to switch it off and on, to change the configuration, and they don't like business logic that changes all the time. Reverse proxy are like technical bricks. API gateways can be changed dynamically, and then they are not unfriendly to business logic. I always use the same example that you have rate limiting on your reverse proxy. I see you. And if you have a reverse proxy, you have rate limiting, every client is considered the same because it's a technical component, right? In an API gateway, you probably are dealing with APIs, and then depending on who is paying you more money, you might want to like give a higher rate limit to some clients. And this is business logic. So while this can be done in a reverse proxy, it was not designed to do that. So you will need to find somebody who code in C to write the module, to compile the module, and then to like put the module, like hot load the module, which is not great. So that's a very, very short difference explanation. You have many, many APIs gateway available. Here I only wrote first the one I knew, because there are many, and then the one that you can install on-premise. You can also have API gateways that are on your cloud provider, but personally, I've known the time where you had no choice about using a Windows desktop, so I'm very, very afraid to get to a cloud provider and to be locked in anyway. I work personally on the Apache APISIX API gateway. It's depending on your point of view, either like quite recent or quite established. And basically, it builds upon the Nginx reverse proxy. The problem with Nginx, as I mentioned, is if you want to change the configuration, you need to switch it off and on again. And so for that, we have a layer called OpenResty. OpenResty is a Lua layer, so Lua, the programming scripting language, that allows you to change the configuration on Nginx and keep it running. And then because OpenResty can be improved, we have an additional layer, and everything afterwards is a plugin. And as I mentioned, you introduce the API gateway, and everything is fine. So this talk is demo-based, so I will try to prove you and to show you how it works. So the first thing is I will start the Docker Compose, and then I will talk about it. Docker Compose up. And you can see here that Docker asks me to update, and I have a strong urge to update, but I didn't do it just before my demo. This is self-control. This is really like high self-control. So here I have this Docker Compose file. I have APISIX. I don't have the latest version. I think the latest version is 3.6.1. They released it yesterday or something like this. Also, very good self-control. APISIX stores its configuration in etcd, like the distributed key value store, so I need to install it. I have the APISIX dashboard. If I have some time, I will show it to you. Then I have Prometheus, because I want everything to be monitored. And I have Grafana, because visualization. And then I have my old API, and I have my new API. Of course, normally you shouldn't have your new API ready, but here it's Docker Compose, so it's much, much much easier. So I have my old API, and the old API is a Spring Boot project, and I can show you how it works. Curl localhost 8081, and I say hello. Amazing, right? And then I have the new API. And the new API, you don't see it here, but I rewrote everything in Kotlin, because Kotlin is so much better. And I removed all the annotation, and now you see my hello world is much better. So the idea is I want to move from the first version to the second version. As I mentioned, you introduce an API gateway, and everything is already better. So let's try it. And here, it doesn't work, because I just installed the API gateway, so I need to configure it. How do we do it? Well, in Apache APISIX, you use a curl command, or at least an HTTP endpoint, to configure your API gateway. So I use Docker Compose, and since I wanted to show off a bit, I'm using a Docker image, so you don't need to install curl. So I need to set the network, then I'm using the routes endpoint, and because changing the configuration of the API gateway is a critical operation, I need to pass the API key. So of course here I use the default one, but you need to change it. And then you can give it a name, you give it an URI, and then if there is a matching with the URI and the methods. So methods are optional. I think by default they are get and post. then they will the API gateway will forward it to the upstream, which is the old API. And because I want everything to be monitored and everything is a plugin in Apache APISIX, I add the Prometheus plugin. So now if I run it and I redo this, then now it works. Yeah. Thank you. You will come after me. I have Swiss chocolate for you. Well, I am back to square one, right? That it works is great, but basically we are at the same stage. So we don't have versioning at the moment. That's the biggest problem. So we need to introduce versioning. There are three different ways to put versioning in your API. The first one, the one that I will use here, is path-based versioning. Easy peasy, slash v1 directs to v1, slash v2 directs to v2, or whatever. Second way that I've never seen used anywhere is query-based. So you add a question mark, version equals whatever, and depending on this, you forward to one version or the other. The third one is header-based. This one is much more common. So it can be either a custom header or a content accept header. Here I will use path-based because it's the easiest one, but you can do whatever you want with Apache APISIX. So I will do this. And instead of creating directly a route that embeds the upstream, I will create a dedicated upstream. So there is another endpoint because it's an abstraction. I want to reuse it across several routes. So here I will use the upstream. So it's just the embedding port. Key not found. That starts very, very badly. So, oh, yes. This here, sorry. And then I can create the plugin configuration. And why should I do it? So it's another endpoint. Because otherwise, for every route, I would need to explicitly add the Prometheus plugin. But I told you I want to monitor everything. So I want it to be applied by default. And for that, global rule. I create it. And finally, I create the route. So instead of putting the upstream here, I just put the upstream ID that I created. And something fun is, because we are using path-based, we need to do something like very tricky. If we just forward it, we will forward v1 slash hello to the upstream, and the upstream doesn't know v1 slash hello. It only knows hello. So we need to remove the v1 prefix. This is what I'm doing here. So now I have two endpoints, right? I will show you here that normally it's 9,000, if I remember well. Or not, yes. It's a dashboard. Don't tell anybody what the password is. Again, this is a demo, you should change it. Here you can see the upstream list. I've created the path to the old API, and we have two routes, the version one and the unversioned one. And if, in case, you can view the JSON, and you say, I don't know, version RATI, because I have no clue. And then it's directly changed in the configuration. This is the dashboard. Great. So now we have two versions. Like we have, two routes, the unversion one and the v1. So first problem, people who are still using the unversion route won't change. Why? It works. Second problem, people, new clients, might use the inversion one, well, because they don't know better, or because you type less characters, or whatever. So we need a way to tell people, hey, don't use the inversion route anymore. It's not valid. The problem is when you design your API, you were so happy to deploy it that you forgot about making people register. So you don't know who your clients are. So the only way to tackle that is to use our friend, the HTTP status code 301. So when clients are using the unversion route, they will have an error. How can we do it? That's very easy. Again, it's a plugin, with direct plugin. So now, when clients are actually using your endpoints and it's unversion, they say, hey, no, you need to use the v1/hello. And this is a very important lesson. Even if you are only consuming APIs, you should also monitor usage, because otherwise everything breaks and you have no clue about it. But you can tell me, hey, but we are much, much smarter than that. What we do is we do automatic redirect and still works. So we don't need to change anything. Okay, but you just doubled your number of requests, right? You make a request, then it returns 301, then you make a second request. So you just doubled your number of requests, probably your cloud bill. So even if you are doing auto redirect, you should always, always monitor your API consumption. So now is the time where we need to address the first sin. We didn't ask for people to register. And probably for good reasons, because who here likes to give out their emails? One person? One person. Why do you like to give out your email? You like to receive crazy, useless marketing emails? You are very friendly. Give me your email, yeah. And I you will receive lots of friend requests from all over the world. The problem, yeah, we don't like to give out our email because most of the time it's just not so very interesting. But what we like is free stuff. We are giving out our emails to receive like cups and t-shirts and stickers and like be part of the raffle. So we could probably hack that and try to say, okay, if you give out your email, we let you keep unlimited calls to our API, and if you don't, you will be rate limited. That's a good incentive. So unfortunately, at the moment, there is no easy plugin for that, so I had to hack my own plugin. And I'm not a Lua developer. Who here is a Lua developer? Okay, I show you the code then. I'm not ashamed. So what I did is, I'm not a developer anymore, but I still can do some development. So I just copy-pasted an existing plugin, the rate-limiting plugin, and I added my own logic, because that I know enough. So this is the logic, and basically this logic says, okay, if you are authenticated with the keyword plugin, then you skip executing the rest of the function, you return, so no more rate limiting, right? That I could do. So now I have this plugin called Unauth Limit. And if I curl v1, I'm rate limited. The registration itself is outside the scope of this talk. APISIX integrate with Keycloak, YDC, whatever you want. Let's say that I will use the simplest stuff ever. I will say, okay, if I will create a consumer, so we also have this consumer abstraction in APISIX, so consumer's endpoint, and it says, if I have a header with name API key, with value my key, I will be authenticated as Jundu. And so I will be able to bypass the rate limiting. So now if I say here, H API key, my key, no URL specified, what happened here? Great success. Thank you, thank you. Yeah, it's a bit more feeble than before, but okay, I will let it pass for this time. Next step. Now we are much better, everything works, we know our users, it's time to deploy V2. But before we deploy, we test, right? Who is doing unit testing? You're not sure. Who is doing integration testing? Who tests in production? And again, you lied. Everybody tests in production. Everyone. Because you can have the best unit test ever, the best integration test ever. There is always like something in the production workload that your test didn't catch. So you need to test in production. You agree? Yeah, that's pretty solid. Huh? That's fact. The thing is, before we do that, we want to like be a bit careful. So generally, we do canary release. We release only to a fraction of the people. But actually, before doing canary release, what we can do is we can fork the production workloads, send it to the V1 and the V2, check the HTTP status code of both, and discard the response of the V2. And since everything is monitored, we can check that actually they are more or less the same response codes. So let's do that. And I won't surprise you if I tell you that we can do it with a plugin. This is called the Proxy Rewrite plugin. And here I need to tell you something that I'm quite proud of. So I work on APISIX since 1 year and a half. And the thing is, the plugins, they have a hard-coded priority because you need to like execute the logic in order. So for that, you have a priority. And before I came, the problem was the priority of the proxy mirror was higher than the priority of the proxy rewrite. So basically, first you fork the workload, and then you remove the V1 prefix, which didn't work that well. So now you can change the priority a bit because it's an abstraction and blah, 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 but I don't want to go into more details. But now what you can do is you can change the priority of the proxy rewrite so it executes before the proxy mirror. So we can do some like load on it. And I will add Eva there. So now you are famous. And now we can check our friend Grafana. So if I remember, it's 3000 and API6. This is a default API6 dashboard. I just added two widgets. So here is the HTTP status call for the upstreams, the old API and the new API. And of course, here it should look about the same. So here it was monitored since the beginning, so the scale is different, but basically here and here it should look the same, and the yellow one with the parameter, it should look the same. So here it looks the same, of course, with free calls and on the demo stuff, it's pretty obvious. But at this stage, normally we can say yes, everything works as expected, or no, we get back and understand why there is a difference. So here, everything is good. So now it's time to do our friend the canary release. Who knows where the canary release name comes from? Nobody? Ah, yeah. Where does it come from?
Mining,
yeah. So the idea was, when people were still going to coal mines, and I think it still exists in some parts of the world, you had this canary because there was a gas that when you would mine would be released, and it was toxic. And it was odorless. You had no way to know about it. So if the canary like died, then probably you knew that the gas was released and it was time to run away very, very fast. And it's the same case here. We will just have this canary release to check that everything works as expected. And in case, we can do some rollback. You can do canary release based on the fraction. You can base it on like IP addresses, on the header, on GeoIP if you want, whatever you want. Here, because for the sake of the demo, I will do it only on a fraction and not a small fraction. Hello. I will do it on half-half. So I remove the proxy mirror, and I do the traffic split. So here I have deployed the V2, and I will like have the weight of 1 to the first upstream and of 2 to the second upstream. So normally, if I now call here, about half the time, I will get the V2. Amazing. We are pretty good, right? So we start, let's say, with 1%, then 5%, then 20%, then 50, and then, okay, we release the V2. Not here, here. We release the V2. It's too cool. And now we can release V3, V4, V7. And now we have lots and lots of versions in parallel. So if you are an engineering manager, you know it's not a great place to be, because now your budget must be spread across all those versions. So what do? We deprecate them. And the problem comes is, how do we deprecate an HTTP endpoint? And it's not really like specified. The thing I came upon was an ITF draft. So take it with a pinch of salt, but since there is nothing else, I would encourage you to use it. You just add a deprecation header with a future date or a Boolean. For the demo, I will use the Boolean because I'm super lazy, but you should never, ever use the Boolean, right? You want to forewarn your user that it will be deprecated in the future. We just don't want to tell them, hey, it's deprecated today, and tough luck. Then you have a link header to point to the new API to use. And if you want to be extra nice, you have a sunset header. Like deprecation says, at this point, at this date in the future, it won't be supported. Sunset means at this point in the future, it won't be there anymore. So it just tells people about the whole life cycle that you want to implement. So let's do it. And it's here now. And now I use the V1. I need to be verbose, otherwise you won't see anything. So here, I have the link, and I set deprecation equals true, but it should be a date. And if you want to be like extra, extra good, you want to be lazy, you just use Nginx variables. So you don't need to hard code anything. And that's it. The next step is the easiest. Enjoy. I believe that if you implemented all the tips and tricks that I've shown you in this talk, then the next time your business comes for V3, then it will be a much, much easier work, because you will know your user, you will know how to deploy nicely, and everything will be fine. Thanks for attention. If you are still on Twitter, I'm still on Twitter as well, but I don't tweet a lot. If you are on Mastodon, I'm there. If you are on Blue Sky, I'm there. I'm trying to be everywhere until like Twitter breaks down. If you're interested about the code repo, everything is on GitHub. And because I want to check everything. Where is my light? Here. It's a bit.ly code, so I can check how many people did actually open the link to look at the code. And if I got you interested in Apache API6, please have a look. Thanks a lot. And now there are perhaps some questions.
Any I have questions? One question.
I have one question on Moova. So Milan Milanovic asked, I wonder if you can evolve your APIs without explicit versioning. Yeah, the problem is not evolving your APIs with versioning or without versioning. The problem is, how many clients do you want to break? If you don't have versioning, that means that every change you make needs to be backward compatible. And backward compatible changes, they are very rare and few. If you add an endpoint, that's a backward compatible change. If you add an optional parameter, it's a backward compatible change. As soon as you try to change the type or change anything, it's not a backward compatible change anymore. So at this exact moment, I'm using an API, and I want to check my number of followers on some social media. And the thing is, they return the whole list of followers in an array. And I tell them, that's pretty stupid. I'm not interested in who is following me. I'm interested in the number to have a nice dashboard. So just put somewhere the number of followers so I don't need to paginate and count by myself. And of course, it's a very good idea, so they are super happy about it. But because they return an array, it cannot be done. They would need to return an object. That's a backward incompatible change. So they don't need to version it, but if they don't do, they will break everybody using their endpoint. So that's a good lesson. If you want to design an evolving API from the beginning, always, always return objects and not arrays. Other questions? Wow. It can mean two things. Either it's the best talk ever, or it's the worst one and you don't want to shame me publicly. I would like to be in between, huh? Unless everybody agrees it's the best talk ever. So please, one more question. Yeah, oh, thank you.
Yeah, hi. My name is Vladimir. You mentioned comparing response codes. Can you compare response bodies also?
Yes, of course, you can compare response bodies. It will just take more time. It will be more computation intensive. So depending on your load, it might not be the great idea. Or perhaps you would like to compare the response statuses of every request and just sample a few of them to compare the bodies. But of course, it's possible. No, here I was not using the plugin to compare. I was just sending everything to Grafana. So here, if you want to actually store the body, that's different. That's just not only Prometheus. Probably you will need to log somewhere. We can do that, but it's not in the plugin that I've shown you. It's a lucky plugin, so you can log. Other questions?
Hey, I wanted to ask, when you mentioned splitting and then comparing the results, how would you do it for mutating API calls?
Mutating, sorry?
Mutating API calls, which delete or change stuff.
That's a really, really good question, and you don't do it. You don't want to do it unless you have the exact replica of the database, which can also be done. But it's more effort. So it's like comparing the bodies. You want to have more insurance, but it's more expensive. But you can at some point try to fork the state of the database, and you have mutating stuff, and you can also compare the state of the database afterwards. But in this case, you must be really, really sure that they are doing the exact same stuff. And it's very hard to trace the state to one of the requests. But it's possible. I wouldn't encourage you to do that, because I believe this kind of stuff, if you deploy multiple times a day, then this is prohibitive in terms of costs. But depending on your context, if you are working in the banking industry, you want to be really, really sure. And it could be a good idea, yes. And in banks, generally, you don't deploy multiple times a day. You deploy once per 3 months. Other questions? Yep. I knew it. Once the first question starts, it's like, way, everybody has questions. That's good.
Yeah, my question would be, the plugins are written in Lua script, and I don't think Lua is really known for its performance. So what is the performance hit if you apply plugins?
If you apply plugins, the problem is the performance question. I've done a couple of talks in my life, and the performance questions always comes up. The thing is, not everything is about performance. So if you want in your environment to be like, because you have requirements about performance, you need to do the benchmarks in your own infrastructure on the production setup. Don't believe any benchmark by any vendor. And the thing is, my experience, but I never worked in micro trading or whatever. So, but my experience in regular businesses is that performance is most of the time not a criteria. In my environments, in my previous environments, we valued flexibility, agility, all those ETs much more than just raw performance. So I don't answer your question directly, but be very, very careful about this performance question. A couple of years ago, I don't know if there are any Spring Boot developers. I was a Spring Boot developer, and I had played with the actuator. So the fact that you've got like DevOps endpoints that let you actually monitor your application. And so I did this talk a couple of times, and every time I had the question, yeah, how much overhead does it add to your solution? And my answer was always like, hey, is it better to go very fast and not knowing where you are going instead of like be a bit slower and just know where you are heading? And I understand again that in some very specific environments, like performance is the number one requirement, but most of the time it's not. And you need to compare, going back to the actuator, that if you have something that is given you for free, instead of having the business like set the requirements, they will never, or having you to set your requirements, and then who is going to pay for that? Because the business, hey, it has no business value, right? It should be batteries included. We don't care about it. You have no budget. Do it. So this is something to take into account. The plugin system is very, very flexible. And for me, that's a lot of value. Again, it depends a lot on your context. But in most contexts I have worked in, this is invaluable. Other questions? OK, thanks a lot.